Hello friends, Arts Poetica, this is our third lecture. Last lecture I told you, I made a mistake, that is, I thought that ballads has not been included in the classification of Horace. But actually ballads come within lyrics, as we can say, lyrical ballads. Wordsworth gives the title Lyrical Ballads. So ballad is also included. Satire, everything is included in that way.
Yes.
So we can say we are Ars Poetica, art of poetry. But it's not only poetry that he discusses, but he also discusses drama, tragedy, comedy, and satire, and other things connected with that. Now we have seen so far 5 points, I think. First one is keep to nature's original. That's vision. Keep to nature's original means don't disturb. Say example again, you can see what pictura poesis. Like painting is poetry. So in painting you don't disturb. So also in poetry you should not disturb. That's what he says.
Yes.
So then next point is, we have seen this as well, I am not writing this on the board. Next point is that manageable subject. You should take subjects which you can manage. Then eloquence and then charm and excellence, etc. will follow. It's nothing to worry about that. So you need not labor for that. That's what it is. Understand? And then we also saw that you should follow tradition. A poet should follow tradition. What does that mean? Means you should follow the Greeks especially, because throughout the essay you will find that the Greeks are praised very much above the Romans. Yes. He is a Roman, but he praises the Greeks, especially Homer. Homer is considered to be his what we should say the example that everybody should follow. So his epic poetry should be written like Homer's epics. Then for sorrow you should follow lament and sorrow, you should take up lament as well, elegy and so on. That is this, no? Lyric for victory and winning horse in the race, the sorrows of youth, love and things like that. That's what the beauties of nature. This is what you should include in lyric. And then the other things we have seen, that is satire and tragedy and comedy, and then tragic comedy, whether you can approach tragedy and comedy, these things we have seen. And then the next point that he yesterday that we were talking is that consistency in describing characters. If I was speaking, if you are describing somebody is giving a threat, there should be anger in this speech. Achilles, for example, he says. If you are describing Achilles, he should be raging and furious and arrogant and never downing weapons, fierce above law, such a person. Understand that? Like that. So, that is, characters should be described true to the original. That's what he says, characters. And then I see comic characters should be comic and tragic characters should be tragic. And language also used for individualism. And the fifth point that we saw is that then there are he recognizes 4 stages of man, as we have seen: the lad, beardless youth, manhood, and the 4th is aged man. So each man, when he appears on the stage, a lad should not speak like an aged man. A aged man should not speak like a beardless youth, like that. That is what he means by saying, describing the style, the words given, and some characterization. And so today we go on to the next few points. Very simple. So nothing to explain, so to say, but still the first one is speaks about sixth. The sixth point is chorus, gods, then music. This is what is this music. Sixth point is that. Say that every drama should have 5 acts. Neither less nor more. So this is the classical unity. let me say, no? Classical unity, time and action. Now this is about the structure itself, five acts. See that? Then the only three characters should be present at the time on the stage, and they should speak, not any other person. So these are certain laws given. It's a law given, it's known as a law given. And gods. Pasadena speaks about gods. Gods, they can intervene in a human action. But only when it is needed. You should not call a god for fixing a tap, or to wash basin or something, not like that. Very important things. When do you go to oracles? You are unable to solve that problem. You need some spiritual help or some supernatural help, then you go. So like that. So you can ask the intervention of gods, but that should be one serious matter, not a chorus. Very important. It's as good as a character. So then chorus should advance the action. Chorus should support the virtuous and guide and oppose. Oppose and guide the wicked. That's what it says. So they have a function. Chorus has a function. And the function is to advance the action. Not always singing and always doing. At times. So it's as good as a character, that's the thing. And it just got, if you see, look at the chorus in Dr. Faustus, you can see. The chorus is a warning of Dr. Faustus. Don't sign that deal with Mephistopheles. Okay? And then they are lamenting. Then the chorus is lamenting. So, but at the same time, good things, good angel, bad angel. Yeah. So that's all part of chorus. So that is the function of the chorus. Chorus is very important. It's an actor, so to say. Yeah, then what about music? Music, you say, if the audience is aristocratic, honest and modest, genuine, and fruitful, a simple fruit like this, without any decorations on it. It's light, it's a solemn music. Suppose the audience, you have got a mixed bag. You have country people and then city people, then literate and illiterate, aristocratic and the ordinary, the common, all mixed together and noisy. Then you need a strong fruit and also lyre, so that the music should defeat, so to say, or overcome the sound of music. Sound of Music is the name of the title of a film, isn't it? So sound of music should be above this cacophony of this mixed bag of audience, so that at least some people can enjoy. So that's simple things, no? So gods should not intervene unnecessarily. Chorus has a very important position. It's like a character, and music very light if it is audience is very calm and quiet and honest and modest, see. Otherwise, that's what we are, we can hear now also, no? Then you have got a high voltage, yes. If there is a large crowd and a mixed crowd, or suppose in a small, for example, the other day I was listening to a recital of ghazals, yes, ghazal, you know. That is, Chaudhami, Ka, Chand, Ho, etc. There are so many in Hindi and Malayalam. Devan. So Devan and his party. So the light, very light sound, you can see. Music. Music played is very soft and very light. See that? Mm-hmm. Very soft, yes. Otherwise, it's a female song, it's yes. And then, seventh point is, in others, he deals with every aspect of poetry and drama. It's actually a compendium. Can I use that word? It's not big, but in ideas, the presenting the ideas, dissemination of ideas, it is a big and a great contribution. Its size, magnitude, yes. Its magnitude is very great, we can understand. So now next is next about style. Style, then tragedy. Style and tragedy. Style or a satire, and the style that used by fonts, no? Then characters introduced from wood, no? And then the need for charm and novelty. Charming, charm for, no, novelty for charm, not charm for novelty. Novelty for charm. Charming effect, yes. Just a tragedy should be serious. That should be serious. Otherwise, there is a comparison. It would be like, if the language is not serious, style is not serious, then it would be like compelling a lady to dance in a crowd. So, and she will have to suffer the shame. So that is serious style for tragic. Tragic characters must speak serious and eloquent and solemn language. There is also satire. Satire is, in satire, I don't use tame and gentle words, that I don't use. Tough words. Because it is satire, no? It's an attack. Therefore, tough words should be used. And fawns, he says. Fawns in English from wood and forest and so on. These are kind of characters, no? They should not speak filth, and there are smutty jokes, they will not say. Smutty and filth are obscene language. They should not speak. So, it's very simple. The style in tragedy should be serious, satire should be tough, and you should not. And in the mouth of fawns, you should not give these filthy and smutty jokes and obscene language. And then he says, people will be shouting for charm, so novelty. Should give them, novelty, again, just as we have seen in one of our last classes, skilled juxtaposition, like the metaphysicals, that will give novelty. You can do that if you want, that is what he says. Then, eighth point, you are following a very simple. It is about meter, use of meter in poetry and also in drama. He prefers iambic for drama, tragedy, serious, solemn, spondy for serious and solemn, and epic, we have seen yesterday, that is dactyl, yes. Now all the three has got a special ways of stressing and unstressing. See, an iambic foot, should I show you, unstressed, what is it? Spondy, too stressed, solemn. This one is the tap, tap, as I told you. Then the last one. Dactyl already you have seen. What is it? That is, you have got a one stress and two unstress. Feet you can have any number. 5 feet, 6 feet, 7 feet. Here also. There's another one in a trochee. That is opposite of spondy. That is trochee. Trochee is too short. That is Understand? This will be ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. Is it? Ta-ta. So, this will be ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. This will be ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. Like this. Sharp. Too sharp. So, style, he is speaking about iambic, spondy, and then that. So, it's simple, isn't it? Yes. Another ninth point that he is speaking about is, he said the Greeks are superiors. Greeks are superior to the Romans. We are the Romans, but they are greater than us, he says. They are greater than us, he says. So that is, he says the Romans are greater. No, no. Say tragedy, for example, originated in Greece. The Thespis. The originator of this place. And then the one who reformed it, made it more beautiful is Aeschylus. The speech originated it. Then what happened, you know, his stage was a platform of a cart. A cart, look, a CRT cart, lorry. Yes. What is called a pickup van or something like that. But those days there was no something, so platform of a cart. And the characters, not much makeup, except some wine leaves they poured around. And they acted and they sung. They were singing and they were acting. And they were acting and singing. Very simple, no? Maybe in the marketplace. The start with this is the marketplace. So a platform of a cart, or you can say the small part of the cart, you know, where you carry things, luggage and things like that. That may be acted and singing. And wine leaves, they spread wine leaves on their face. That is the only makeup, simple makeup. Then when it's coming to Aeschylus, there's a wooden platform, some wooden planks. And he is the one who started, the character should wear fine robes, see, fine robes and wearing masks. Understand? The characters should wear masks and they should wear fine robes and they should speak sonorous poetry. That's the thing. Sound should be the resounding sound. Some characters should speak like that. So that is about then about comedy. Interesting thing, he speaks about old comedy, old comedy. Why does he say old comedy? I don't know. But that may be. After all, God began, life always begins with the laughter. So it's old comedy. Yeah. So here what happens is that comedy trespassed, you can say, or they went beyond all possible limits. So there was a ban on comedy. There was a legal action not to perform comedies. Because there is no control as decorum. It's not decorum. See? One way if you think like that, you know, one way of thinking is in paradise where Adam and Eve were given a heavenly dwelling place and habitat, etc. There was also decorum, a limit. God said in that myth of creation, God said, what do God say? You can eat everything except this. So that is a decorum, a limit in our life also, you can say. So in one way, if you argue, you can say, it is Aristotle's golden mean. Aristotle, what is it? Virtu stat in media. That's what he said. Virtu stat in media. What does that mean? What does that mean? Virtu means virtue. Virtue stands in the middle. And what does that mean? No extremes. Neither this extreme or not that extreme. I'll give an example. Suppose you are a very good student. 24 hours you are studying. That is one extreme. You are a very good student. You don't study at all. Just listen to the class and go. You don't even open your book. That's another extreme. Between this, you have got the middle. The middle path is the golden mean versus golden mean. And that is decorum. Golden mean. And that is equivalent to decorum. You can say decorum. So here, comedy has got all decorum. Therefore, this banned. Comedy was banned, yes. Then, what happened is that this tragedy and comedy, everything was tried by the Romans. But they could not reach anywhere near the Greeks. So that is why it says Greeks are superior. Taking the examples of tragedy and comedy and the other forms of literature, says Romans tried. Maybe Romans might have tried too much on comedy, that's why comedy was banned, that we don't know. Yeah. Then the tenth and the last point today. Now we have just 4 more points. That's a very serious he can say, it is somewhat serious, that is about good poet, definition of a good poet, or description of a good poet. Who is a good poet? So in good poet, he says, the most important thing is talent, not technique. That's simple. For a good poet, talent is important, not technique. He says, melody is nonsense. This is the phrase that he uses. Melody is nonsense, without content. So if there is no content, there is no point. You can go on using picturesque language, you can comparisons, you can have a simile, you can have a spondy, iambic, and trochee, and dactyl, or whatever you want. But suppose there is no content, this melodious nonsense. That's a very important point. Melodious nonsense. So, talent is important, not technique. So, wisdom. You must have wisdom. And he says, follow the Socratic writers. Socratic writers, the followers of Socrates. Because they have wisdom. If you have got wisdom, then eloquence and charm will automatically follow. That's why. You have wisdom. Otherwise, you try this, you try that, you try to correct this, you try to rewrite this, you stitch and re-stitch and stitch and re-stitch, you go nowhere. The whole thing will become a clumsy thing. Understand? So what is important is wisdom, like the Socratic writers. Now if you want to a good characterization, then you should know about life. You should know what are the duties to parents, what are the duties to your brothers, what are the duties that you have to perform to the guests, how a judge functions, what are the qualities of a judge, how does a general in the army behave, what is his characters, his qualities, etc. We should know. Only after knowing this, we can present a character as a general, or as a king, or as a queen. Without that, you cannot. So you want to first-hand information. He says, I am a poor poet. He accepts that. I am a poor poet. But I am a grindstone. I can wet steel, although I do not cut. That's what he says. Understand? I can wet steel and see these things happening. I can assess. I can assess. Although I am not a good poet or a good writer. But we know he was a great writer, isn't he? He wrote lyrics, odes, and then satires, see? So then you can say, these are the important things about the poet. Poet, most important thing is talent, not technique. That's one. Secondly, you can use all kinds of ornaments, as Bacon says, studies serve for service. Studies serve for delay, for ornament, and for serve for delight. Yes. Studies serve for delight, for ornament, and for quotation, some things like that. He says, no, I just forgot that the last part of it. You can complete. Yeah. So there you are. So ornaments, that's what I want to say. So you can have lots of ornament on it, but no use. If the content is not up to the standard. So for content you say, go to Socratic writers. They will be showing you how. And wisdom is most important. Once wisdom, you have got the wisdom, then other things will follow. So if you want characterization, and then here comes lyrical ballads, professional lyrical ballads. Then he says, in professional lyrical ballads, Wordsworth says, your real language of real life of people expressed in real language of living language, real language. And that is what he also says. You should express, writers should describe or express real life of people in living language. That's important. Not dead language, because there can also be dead language, isn't it? Otherwise, what happens is you will be in a yes. And then here also he compares the Greeks with the Romans. You see, Romans tried again in this sort of thing. But what Romans are interested in long divisions, he says. So the Greeks are much superior to them. And he asks the question, how can we hope to make a poem? Romans, how can we hope to make a poem if you don't have this thing? First talents, then wisdom, then real life experience, then using living language, then you are a great poet. That's what it says. So the Romans are not, the Greeks are to be admired. Yes, understand. Yeah. So these are the points. Now we have seen so far. So chorus, God's, the intervention of God should be limited only to the point. Chorus is an actor. Chorus should, the function of chorus is advance the action of the play. And the chorus should advise and guide the evil people and support the good people. The chorus should pray for luck for the poor, simple people, and also just the opposite, that is, not a curse, but the luck and the good living of cruel people should be taken from them and given to the good people. That's what the chorus should do. Music, aristocratic, otherwise bombarding. Yes. Yeah. Then next style is tragedy, serious, satire, tough. Form should not use ugly words and smutty jokes and obscene language. For charm, you can use novelty, novelty in the way of skillful juxtaposition. Meter, he speaks about iambic, spondy, dactyl, and crocky. Crocky, he doesn't say this. Just for the general mode, I have only that. The Greeks are superior to the Romans in tragedy. And what happened? Originator of Thespis, then he reformed it. He acted on a cart, and here this man put a stage, and also robes and makeup and other things. Comedy lost all. They transgressed and trespassed, you can say. And therefore, old comedy banned. And there's no decorum. And good poet, most important is talent, not technique, wisdom. Socratic writers, these are main points. Real life experience you should have, real language, living language. The Romans unable to do any of these things because they are more interested in the divisions, long divisions. Understand? Once again, I would say that throughout arts, where again, the key word is decorum. Everywhere there should be some decorum. Decorum means in a moderate. Things should be moderate, neither that extreme or this extreme. And that is what Aristotle says, golden mean. Virtu, start in media. Virtu means virtue, start means stand. Media means middle. That means not this extreme or that extreme. This is what he also says. So in the classical world, they already had this idea. It's a common thing they had, they shared, that there should be decor. Any man with a sense, any sensible man will definitely support this idea of decorum. In our life also, in our day-to-day life also, we need decorum. Without decorum, how can we live? It's impossible for us, no? You can't exist. Suppose that person, there is too much of anything is bad, no? Even elixir, amrit. Suppose you are drinking from morning till evening, what will happen? It will have a poisonous effect on your body. Understand? Okay? Is that clear to you? Alright, so I think that by tomorrow, in our fourth lecture, we will be able to complete this Ars Poetica. And then we will move on to Longinus, the idea of sublime. He wrote in 1st century AD. Understand? This is BC. Yeah. So fine. Well, if you go through this, or this Ars Poetica, you will see, He had laid the foundations of everything, not only aesthetics, but also our life, that is decorum. Right? And two other words, the last class also I told you, two other words are dulce et docere. That means entertainment, pleasure, and and the teaching, the art. It has got, you can see, it has got its impact on later years. As we can see, there was a movement for arts, for art for art's sake. And then the Madhya Arnold is now, it's for teaching, means that is culture, isn't it? What is the best that is taught and said? So culture is more of what you should say, teaching, isn't it? Morals. Madhya Arnold focused on morals. But the art, there is also a movement for art's sake. Now, all these things I told you came from this. The fountain is this, or the base is this, or the foundation is this. Therefore, the classical Aristotle as well as Horace, they are, both of them, you can say, they are the lawgivers. They laid the foundations of aesthetics. They laid the foundations of genre, like epic and epic on, and the list you can see, epic, lyric, satire, tragedy, comedy, lament, that is elegy, short elegy, all those things. Understand? So, it's worthwhile to do this, to learn this, even if you are not a student. If you would like to enjoy literature and the works of art, I think this would be a great help to you. Understand? To us, not to you, to me also, to all of us. That read the original text and see the beauty of the language. Originally it's in Latin, but the translation at least. Okay. So, until we meet again, bye. Have a nice time. Enjoy your life. Take it easy. Bye.